Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, the grey area between male and female. What's it like to live in between? Is gender a spectrum?
So if this is female and this is male, I'd say I'm pretty much here.
I wanted to be the manliest man.
I use no preferred pronouns.
Binary gender doesn't work.
Almost too many labels are starting to exclude lots of people.
I do think it's important to be able to have that label and for somebody to be able to understand themselves.
Thank you so much for being here. Before we get started, let's break down what we're looking at here tonight. For most of our lives, gender has been spoken about in terms of male or female. It's what's on our birth certificates, it's what we fill out in surveys, it's how we group ourselves, basically by gender. But increasingly, how people identify what their gender is isn't so black and white. So we're hearing the word non-binary a lot more, essentially neither male nor female. Grace, you're non-binary but were born female. How were you raised in terms of gender?
My mum made a particular point not to put gender roles on us. And to be honest, it wasn't until I was 12 that I told a teacher, oh, I think I want to be a fighter pilot. And they said, you can't do that. And I said, excuse me. And they were like, no, you are a woman, you can't. And from then on, I just started to notice that there are differences between the genders.
Mm. When did you start identifying as non-binary?
Probably about 5 or 6 years ago. I did stop for a while because I did not like the comments that I got. It's mostly from cis women. I get a lot of, oh, that's weird.
Cis women being?
Women that were born women and still identify that way.
Why do you think they would say that?
I honestly don't know. Maybe they just don't understand. It just seems super reactive, like they are almost getting triggered. So I just stopped for a while. But the past year or two, I felt I've had more space to be myself. So, yeah, I've been more open about it again.
You use he, they pronouns. Can you just explain that for us?
So I've heard the way a lot of people speak about the spectrum. They don't think they're at a point on it, but I would say I feel like I am. So if this is female and this is male, I'd say I'm pretty much here. But I like the space of non-binary because I don't have to be that, because what if I said that I was a man and then I started to explore it and some nuances of it I didn't really relate to. So I just think it gives me freedom to just be me and not really have to explain who I am, and also accept the feminine parts of me too, because I have some really feminine parts that I do feel really proud of.
In which way do you identify as masculine?
It's something I'm not sure how to explain because it's just my personality. I know that when I'm in groups of men, the way I'm socialising feels more comfortable, if it's in a platonic sense. And when I'm in groups of women, I feel like I've picked up on certain things that I can't really do. Like I have to sort of have a sort of particular demeanour that they seem to like. So I'd say that's the way in which I feel masculine.
Do you mind me asking who you date?
I date mostly men. I just feel really safe, like I can be myself when I'm with a man that I'm comfortable with.
How do they respond when you tell them you're non-binary?
I don't really that much, because I do worry being rejected by a partner. It hurts a bit more than just friends, because you just show them all these intimate parts of you. But to be honest, when I do, they don't really say much, which may come across as dismissive, but I feel like they just don't know what to say, so they're giving me the space to be me, and I appreciate that that's what they can offer me, and I really like it.
Do you find your appearance paired with your non-binary identity confuses people?
Oh, they are so confused. I can tell some people just have no idea what's going on.
Right.
And I'm just watching it in their brains. If you want to ask things, you can. Otherwise, no judgment on you. I'm confused by it. Like, if someone said, what exactly is your gender? I'd be like, I don't know. So yeah, I totally understand why they feel like that. Just, I don't need the microaggressions.
Christian, you're a man and you like to wear women's clothes. Why?
I find the concept of gendering fashion to be completely reductive to the conversation that we're having. The items of clothing. I mean, as a kid, I always kind of loved anything that was pink and sparkly. I was never necessarily encouraged to wear dresses, but my parents, if I wanted to, they would absolutely allow me to.
Do people ever assume you're either trans or non-binary because of the way you dress?
Yeah, definitely. It's right. Kind of one of my favourite things is going to the toilet and seeing someone walking after me and be like, oh, sorry, I thought this was the men's. I'm like, it is, I just have long hair. But I think that it's sort of a bit silly that having long hair and wearing a dress suddenly makes you a woman.
You wear women's clothes, you wear men's clothes. When you wake up, how do you decide what to wear?
I just kind of dress however I feel. You know, some days I feel like wearing, I mean, this is my version of boy clothes. But, you know, some days I feel like wearing more masculine things. And some days I wake up and I'm like, no, I want to wear that tiny little tulle dress.
Has your family been supportive of your style?
Very. You know, I've seen a lot recently where people have kind of come out, especially after wearing some things more recently where they're saying that my parents are ashamed of me, and it makes me... I think the reason that I'm kind of able to go out there and do what I do and wear what I wear is because I know that that's not true. I know that they have my back completely, and I also appreciate the privilege that it is to have parents like that, because that's not everyone's experience, unfortunately.
Earlier this year, you wore this to the Logies. What sort of response did you receive, Christian?
I received, without any exaggeration, thousands of negative trolling comments, people telling me to OD, people telling me that I'm a disgrace. I mean, I was very surprised to find out that the patriarchy was so flimsy that it could be taken down by a piece of white silk. But here we are.
Why do you think people reacted so strongly to you wearing a dress?
I think there's multiple parts to it. I think on one hand, it's the idea that, sure, we see these images in America, but suddenly seeing them on our home soil is a little more confronting. And I also think that not only is it homophobic, but it's misogynistic. It's this idea that I'm a male and I'm dressing like a female, and therefore I'm reducing myself. I'm reducing the male population to a female population. It definitely feels targeted towards the fact that not only is it a dress, but it's a feminine dress. It's not right. Brad Pitt in a skirt. It's me with long hair in a silk backless dress.
Monique, you're a woman. You dress in a very feminine way. Were you always a girly girl?
To be honest with you, I actually wasn't. As I was growing up in my school years, both in primary school and high school, I was actually a tomboy in most ways. So I used to play with the boys, play sport with the boys. I never used to wear dresses. I was very masculine minded, but it took until I became actually after 18 to become feminine.
Why did you decide to do that, become more feminine in that sense?
When I was younger, I never thought that I was beautiful. And so I always relied on my academics. And then when I was older, I realised that being feminine is actually a strength. I knew that my career was going to go into entrepreneurship. And I realised that you don't have to be masculine physically to do well in business. So for me, it's worked out perfect because I embrace both men and women and different ways that they approach it.
What is femininity to you?
To me, in a physical sense, I think it's exactly wearing dresses, shoes, wearing makeup, hair, you know, looking quite polished. But then also feminine to me comes from the values. So I believe that the man should be the provider, the protector, the leader in that sense. And that's my feminine approach, especially to relationships. So, and in business, even if I was married, I would be the same. Like, I would like my husband to, you know, be that role, and then I can go into a more feminine role, for example, being the wife and the mother. So, yeah, it's quite values-oriented, but also physically-oriented, how I think about femininity.
And do you get treated a certain way because of the way you dress?
I think people are very respectful to me because
I look feminine and I will always represent the female image as a director of a company.
Where did you learn what it means to be a woman?
To be frank, it came from my mother. But from my father, I also understand that his role was to provide for her as the female.
Pharrell, who were your male role models growing up?
My mum. No. No, it was... I didn't have any, to be honest. The typical would be all the, you know, what I would see in the street, you know, the bikers.
Yeah.
Men in suits. Men of authority. Men who were, let's say, entrepreneurs and had a lot of... an audience around them. But that was just more of an imagery, what it was to be a man as opposed to actually a role model. So I didn't have any the way I guess I would have liked.
What about your father?
He wasn't around. His side of the family is very masculine and very male dominant, or what they define as we're men, who could pull in the most girls, who still has it, even regardless if you're married and have kids.
You were born female, but you can remember feeling male from the age of about 5.
Yeah.
You started to transition at the age of 18. What did that involve?
It was hormone therapy, so testosterone. And then that went on till I was 21, where, again, I was able to get top surgery to remove the breast. So it was just, you know, flat chest. And I had 2 massive scars just running along underneath. I don't really remember the recovery. I just remember being at the gym a week later.
Wow.
I'm like, yeah, I'll just sit. I didn't do anything. I just sat there taking notes. I remember one of the trainers going, didn't you have surgery? I'm like, yeah, a week ago. I'm like,
yeah.
Okay. A lot of ice cream and good recovery.
Were there particular aspects of masculinity you decided to then embrace?
Boxing, kickboxing, were the main aspects of masculinity that I fell in love with, because in a sense within the sport, you know, that's the prompting of, you know, a real men fight, real men, you know, have 6-packs, real men look like, define a real man, and real men will get in the ring and real men will have all these women around. So that was prompting me to go, I want to be a real man. But at the same time, the sport within itself was a very confronting aspect, because you're basically looking at yourself, you're fighting yourself now. So it's a very interesting journey.
Did you feel any pressure around women to live up to that masculine, what you thought was masculinity?
Yeah, I did. A lot of the women that I was around, again, were in the gym environment. So that was that experience of, they were very real men, have 6-packs, real men do this, real men do that. So the pressure from that experience within women within the gym environment, because again, that's a very different, a different area. So yeah, I felt a lot of pressure.
Do you feel comfortable in your skin now?
Yes. I've thought about the surgery down there.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, from my understanding today, even if I did get the transition in the humorous side, I'd be like, well, it's not big enough. It's not this enough. I mean, why did you put that there? What's going on down here? I don't want to do this anymore. This is too heavy. Well, depends. I don't get it, but I get it. But in a sense, and then if I was with a woman, I'd have to explain it anyway. And so you'd still be back to, so you were born a female. It's like, this is a never-ending story and I'm a never-ending complainer. So for myself, it's like who I am now is, if someone, friendship, relationship looks at me or, you know, I'm with you for you, that's the whole point. Regardless of what's changed, what's not changed, I mean, you could still be a general man living your whole life and you could get an unfortunate accident. What are you then? So that's when I felt, you know what, I'm me and I should appreciate me and the person I'm with should value that the same as I do.
Matt, you're a comedian and you have about 300,000 followers on Instagram and TikTok. How do you identify in terms of your gender?
In terms of gender, I still at the moment identify as a cis man or male. It is a journey that I'm currently trying to figure out. Because I don't have any pronouns. I use no preferred pronouns, which means you can call me whatever you'd like. And I've sort of just recently opened up that conversation with my followers to be like, I think something's going on here. I might be non-binary or gender fluid. And so it's something that we're exploring together.
When do you feel most comfortable?
To be honest, it depends day to day. There'll be some times that I wake up and I know that we don't like to put gender on clothing, but let's just say sometimes I'll put on male clothes and I will feel good and that's what I want to wear.
Are you confused about your gender identity?
At the moment, absolutely. Because I think gender can change. You know, everybody sitting here today could have a different opinion on their own gender tomorrow, next month, next year. It's not something, if I found out what that was tomorrow, I would not be afraid to label myself as that, because I know that perhaps in 6 months' time, I could label myself as something completely different, and I'm allowed to do that.
Kerry, you're a sociologist. You focus on gender and sexuality. We've just heard from a lot of people who identify outside of the traditional male-female. What's going on here?
It shows that gender is complex, that binary gender doesn't work for a lot of people. It doesn't suit how they see the world or how they feel comfortable in the world. Mm. But our society has worked in a way that it reinforces particular types of gender onto particular bodies. And it just doesn't work for a whole lot of people. And I think we need to be more aware of just how diverse and personal gender can be in the way that we express it.
Is gender a spectrum?
Absolutely. I think that we've seen tonight, just in this audience, for example, just how broad gender is. It's very diverse, and I think that we need to be looking at how we support gender diversity. If people want to present and express their gender in certain ways, then we should be able to accept that.
What happens when someone does not exist within those norms?
They can either be ostracised, marginalised, they can experience discrimination, they can experience harassment and even violence. And that's really problematic for people.
Mm. Is sexuality different from gender identity?
It is. But it's intimately related to each other in the sense that binary gender assumes heterosexuality. And that relationship then is normalised. It's perceived to be the appropriate sexuality for binary gender. And but the relationship is that it's only intimately connected, but one's identity as sexuality, as sexual being, is very different to being a gendered being. They're different.
Mayanna, you're a transgender woman. You transitioned 25 years ago. Where on the gender spectrum do you see yourself?
I don't really think about it too much. I guess, obviously, I live my life as a woman and that's how I present myself and identify in life.
Do you see yourself as female?
That one gets a bit difficult. I mean, I'm not female, so biological sex is immutable. You don't change it. So I am fundamentally or biologically male, but obviously I've got secondary sex characteristics that are female. And I present myself in society, and for the sake of some documentation, I tick the female box. I guess it just makes things easier. And it's obviously far more appropriate than, say, ticking a male box.
How important is looking like a woman to you?
It's important to me. It's just an integral part of me and how I present myself.
Do you think it's easier for people to wrap their heads around someone, say, like yourself, you look feminine, than someone whose appearance and identity may not match as closely as yours?
Absolutely. I'm sure it is. I mean, lots of people are confused and it's difficult to keep up with it. And, you know, a lot of my friends that I talk to, they're almost walking around on tender hooks all the time with some people in the workplaces because they're afraid about using the wrong terminology or getting reprimanded for using the wrong term or acting inappropriately.
When Juniper was born, we were like they, them pronouns.
Did you consider raising your baby in a gender neutral way?
We just found this just really hard.
The gender reveals haven't been around for too long, a few years now, before you either found out or you didn't. People are, I suppose, impatient as well. They don't want to wait till the end. It's kind of like the initial surprise, but you just don't have to wait so long. You guys are in for a gender scan today. Come on in. Hi, beautiful girls. It's going to be a secret because we're going to do a big reveal.
Yeah.
It gives you a little bit of a head start, just to find out a bit earlier, so you're not left in a bit of a deep end, like straight away, not knowing what you're going to have and not being able to prepare properly.
I want to bother because I have too many sisters. Too many girls in the family.
Alrighty, here we go.
I think it's another girl. I have, like, bad luck with having boys, and I've only ever had girls, so... But we'll see.
Like, it's an adventure, so... You just wait for the excitement to hit you, and it does.
Feeling good with my answer already. Your baby wanted you to know today. Gender disappointment can be a real thing as well, so it's a good way for them to actually find out what the gender is and process that and start bonding with baby.
I'm hoping for a boy, just to continue my legacy. Full sports, fishing, motocross, soccer, anything.
I'm excited to have a boy because something different. I got girls, so a little boy would be great.
You have a little sister.
You're gonna have another little sister.
I was hoping for a brother, but a sister's fine.
Each child we have is a new adventure. It doesn't matter if it's a male, it's just a new story in the book, and you just go from there.
Summer, you and your wife Stephanie had a baby 7 months ago.
We did.
Did you have a gender reveal?
We definitely did not have a gender reveal. I actually did find out after the 20-week scan what Juniper's sex was. As a sort of way of bonding, which is hilarious as a non-binary person. I wanted to know what the sex was. And when I did find out that it was a girl, I actually was really excited in a way that kind of made me feel really uncomfortable because I wasn't the typical girl for my parents that they wanted. They had a boy first and then a girl, but I wasn't the girl that my parents wanted. And in a way that I felt was going to maybe heal me a little bit, also give Juniper more of a chance and more of an open sort of experiences that a lot of kids don't get because of the gender sort of box that they're put in once they're born.
You came out as non-binary 2 years ago at 35. How long did it take to get comfortable with that?
Oh, a very long time. For a very long time, I'd sort of told myself I was androgynous. That was the sort of word that I probably would have used in my 20s. You know, identified as a lesbian. And that was the sort of crowd I hung out with. And a lot of my partners that I'd had at the time were into more androgynous people. And then when I met Steph, I remember Steph, when I started talking about my gender stuff, was like, oh yeah, I was just waiting for you to find that out because I already knew when I met you there was some gender stuff going on. So yeah, Steph was really the catalyst in sort of getting comfortable with being non-binary, at least within like my friend circle.
Mm. You struggled with being raised as a girl.
Mm.
What's it like parenting your baby whose sex is female?
I think it's a bit cathartic because I can sort of, I don't want to say like rewrite history, but I can sort of see the things that like, that I had growing up. And, you know, I was an 80s, 90s kid, so it was a completely different era. And I feel like now I can give Juno the space to do whatever that they want to do, whether it's something that's masculine or feminine. I'm not even thinking about that. Juniper can wear whatever they want. It does not matter.
So how are you raising Juniper?
So when when Juniper was born, we were like, they, them pronouns. We're not going to tell anybody what their sex is unless they change Juniper's nappy. And then we found out probably the first night how hard that was. It just was impossible because every time someone wants to ask if it's a boy or a girl, unless you tell them, they feel like you're attacking them. Mm. They feel like you're being rude for not wanting to tell.
Steph, have you found this attempt to do gender-neutral parenting challenging?
Yeah, I'm half Brazilian. It's a really patriarchal culture. I wasn't even sure how we would do pronouns because it's a gendered language, you know. So there's all sorts of stuff. But I would say that we pretty quickly switched to what I would call gender-responsive parenting, or gender expansive parenting, I guess. One of those is kind of what we're talking about at the moment, because we just want Juno to have space to figure it out for themselves. I think having a non-binary parent will help with that.
You're not a people pleaser, I am. So
yeah, I'm fine with a little conflict, but I just think, why is it always so uncomfortable? Why do we have to tell you what genitals are? In the birth room, we asked no one to announce, because I didn't know. I didn't want to find out when I was pregnant because I didn't want to start imposing societal ideals on my baby. So, yeah.
Kim, 5 months ago, you and your wife, Julie, welcomed your first child. Did you consider raising your baby in a gender-neutral way?
It may have crossed our minds, but coming from a culturally and linguistically diverse family, which is also quite traditional, and they live all the way in Malaysia and Indonesia, which is fun, it's just really hard. We knew for a fact that we already had a big uphill battle to push our people to do that, if we do want to endeavour to actually do that. Whereas we knew that from the moment Morgan was born, everyone asked us our baby's name, from the nurses to the midwives to the doctors and pediatricians and so on and so forth. So we were like, you know, we're going to raise her as she, her, until she corrects us otherwise in the future. And to show her the way, maybe guide her if she needs help, but to allow her the space to find that journey on her own, little 4 feet and then 2 feet.
You're a trans man. You transitioned in your early 30s. You recently stopped your hormone treatment. Why is that?
So I stopped my hormone treatment for the sole purpose of bringing Morgan into this world.
So you decided to go off the testosterone and carry the pregnancy yourself?
That is correct.
Let's have a look at you and baby Morgan and your wife, Julie, at home.
So my name is Julie Lees, and this is my husband, Kim Lee.
That's Morgan.
Our daughter, Morgan, is 4.5 months old.
She's a smiling baby.
She's a personality.
The first time I held Morgan in my arms, she's staring back at you and you're just like, wow.
She's perfect.
Yeah, and everything about her is perfect.
Look at your amazing hair.
We met back in 1999 when we were in high school. We attended a girls' school in Malaysia. I had a crush on him.
Back in 2012, when we were becoming a couple, part of that was just laying all our cards on the table. I shared with her, you know, honestly, I identify as transgender. This was actually the first human being I actually said face to face, and it was a lot for me to actually bring that out and actually share with her. And I said, you know, I'm transgender and I also want to consider medically transitioning in the future. This is really important for me to, one, tell you, and two, if we're going to a relationship, you really should know this. She said, give me a day to think about it. And next day she came back, you know, she said, ultimately, you're still going to be Kim and nothing about you is ever going to change. And from that, she said, yeah, let's give this a go.
Adieu. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that's a happy smell. Hey!
In terms of our journey in creating a family with the IVF, there were a number of pregnancy, but also a number of miscarriages.
That's when I actually told myself that, you know, if it's getting to the stage and Julie's had two miscarriages and it's taken a huge toll on her mental health, what can I do, you know, as a couple and as a team, knowing that I still have my reproductive organs to actually start a family?
If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands.
When Kim shared that he would try to give it a go, it was really a mixed feeling. While I'm very, very grateful, I was very worried for him as well, for his mental health.
being pregnant was not something that I wanted to do, but in order for us to start a family, I was willing to take a step back from my transitioning in order for us as a family to take two steps forward.
Kim, how did you feel about going out in public when you were pregnant?
I think with COVID and everyone had to work from home, it was, for me, a blessing in disguise. As I got more and more pregnant and it got to a stage where I actually couldn't hide the baby bump, that's when my dysphoria just started to become quite uncomfortable to the stage that I didn't even want to leave the house. I didn't even want to, you know, go walk around the neighborhood just for my well-being. I didn't feel like myself, and there were so many changes going through my body, both emotional, physical. I think I was beginning my third trimester, and I was going to a toilet, a public toilet in the city, and I always go to the men's restroom because, you know, I know my space. But I hesitated for that time because I was like, well, will I get clocked, which is, I guess, a term saying that will someone pull me over and say that, well, are you in the wrong restroom? Or because I just felt like, you know, I was taking steps back. Will people start to confuse me for being, you know, unsure of where I fit, either male or female?
What was it like going through the healthcare system as a pregnant trans man?
The fertility process for me towards the journey of actually conceiving Morgan, that was actually quite difficult.
What about paperwork and forms? Did you find they accommodated you?
There were two forms in particular that come to my mind. One form was a legal consent form I had to sign with my fertility centre, but it misgendered me throughout the whole document because they only had legal consent documentation that identified that if you have a baby, you're only a woman or a female. And one of the most important things that Morgan needs is a Medicare card. And when I had to register her in Centrelink, because I was applying for parental leave pay, and with parental leave pay, they advised me that they're going to do two things in one, which is to apply for my parental leave pay and also apply for Morgan's Medicare card and so on and so forth. So I did that, and it came to a question, and it only had three options, which was birthing mother, biological father, and other. Obviously, I don't identify as a birthing mother. I don't identify as a biological father. So I chose other. How I actually identify having a child in my life is I identify as a father, but I also identify as a parent. And I actually waited for 2 months, and I didn't know why they were taking so long. I found out from them that, you know, because I ticked other, it meant that they thought I adopted Morgan, or my relationship with Morgan is due to exceptional circumstances. So they thought I had no relationship to Morgan. So it was a lot of running around, a lot of unnecessary running around for me to actually get that all fixed. I actually just wanted her to have a Medicare card.
Sal, you also recently had a baby. After giving birth, you were given a Medicare form. What did it say on the form?
So on mine, it said birthing parent's name and signature.
Birthing parent's name and signature. Mm-hmm. This was part of the former coalition government's trial in three hospitals to use inclusive language on forms. How did you react when you saw that?
Well, I've been tapped into the sort of gender spectrum debate for a while because of what I do professionally, and I don't agree that woman is an identity, for example. So this world was not foreign to me. So when I saw the form, my reaction was an eye roll because to me it's an ideological language. Now, I have no problem with the concept of being inclusive and making people feel comfortable. This form did not do that. Beyond just making me feel absurd that I was being referred to as a birthing parent when I'm days into being a mother, this form is not, it was a Medicare form. It is not inclusive of adoptive parents. It's not inclusive of gay dads, whether you're heterosexual or homosexual couple adopting a child. this was just this dehumanizing language for a woman. And at the time when I got it, my mum was actually in the room with me. And we sort of had this conversation about how, you know, she was like 37 years into this role of being a mother. I was a few days into it. So to be referred to as a birthing parent, something you do on one day, and have it reduced to that, it's not just offensive, it's just incorrect. It's like, the inclusive word is parent. You don't need the birthing there, because what if it would my partner, who's a guy, wanted to be the one who signed the Medicare form? It was just sort of, it was zoning in on one particular avenue that is just sort of blatantly exclusionary to so many people under the guise of inclusivity.
How did it make you feel in terms of your place as a woman?
Obviously, how you feel as what womanhood is to you can be many different things. I don't think that there's a right or wrong answer with that. Whether you're male or female is objective. You can have any tastes, any personality that you want. For me, it was my reaction was more of this is something that is being imposed upon me, that if I don't accept being called a birthing parent, I'm a bad person. And subsequently, when I did publicly tweet about it, I didn't expect anything to happen because I've been tweeting about this stuff for a long time now and no one's ever done anything about it.
This is the tweet here. What were some of the responses that you got?
Well, because I objected to being called a birthing parent, I was called a bigot, I was called a transphobe. There was media personalities in Australia who said I had no right to even be referred to as a mother. I should only ever be referred to as a transphobe. I'm not phobic of trans people or anyone who has a gender identity that differs from me or what I agree with or anything. There's reality that I live in. It's as simple as that. And if we're getting to a point where we're so, we're trying to sort of be so inclusive that we exclude, aren't we back to where we began?
Mm. Were you surprised at the feedback in the sense of how divisive the issue felt?
No, I've been called a transphobe for 3 years now purely because I say that woman's not an identity.
Right.
I think that anyone should be able to wear whatever they want. I think they should be able to express themselves however they want. It's just there's objective reality and you're male or female and females are the ones who have babies. It's not like I flipped a coin with my boyfriend and I lost and I had to be the pregnant one. I didn't enjoy pregnancy. I'm not gender dysphoric. I'm comfortable in my own skin. I didn't enjoy any part of it. It was a means to an end for me. I love being a mum. And so this idea that men can have babies or things, no, women have babies. Mm. We shouldn't be punished for saying something like that because it is just reality.
Mm. Mayanna, you're a transgender woman. What's your take on gender inclusive language?
Well, it's clearly starting to create some problems, and I think almost too many labels are starting to exclude lots of people. And I think we've got to realise that we do, all of us, represent a really small minority of the human race. Is it really reasonable that we expect the rest of society to be completely rearranged to accommodate the very few of us that there are? And we can't ever expect other people to understand what our lives are. The best we can do, which was always my life as well, was a journey of kind of education. I really would love to see a world where the difference is what's seen as normal, mm, without requiring all the labels and, you know, wear what people like. I mean, Christian over here is almost the embodiment of the thing, something I've been saying for years is, look, who cares if a man wants to wear dresses and heels and makeup or a woman would dress otherwise, who cares? People should wear what they want. The terminology of male and female, man and woman, has been used interchangeably and gender, and they are different things. I think if we need to refer to male and female as the biological sex. It is immutable. It's the gender that we're talking about or the expression of people. If it has man or woman or anything in between, that's the bit that can be variable, but the biological sex can't. And, you know, like I was saying, there's one of them is able to give birth and that's females. And it doesn't matter if they're presenting as a man.
Kim, would more inclusive language have benefited you when you were going through your pregnancy?
It would definitely would have benefited me tremendously. I am biologically female. My gender identity is male, and I understand that. But when it comes to forms, and they're not really quite getting the nuances of my identity and as well as the situation.
What would you have liked that form to say?
I think it should have just included however you identify. I think we should include everybody.
When did Willow raise maybe being non-binary with you?
On Netflix, we've been watching a show called, is it A Day at a Time?
It's One Day at
Sorry.
A Time.
Sorry, One Day at a Time.
Mums always get it wrong.
Always.
I've been married 11 times.
I was in love with love.
If I said it was black, she'd say it was white.
I thought that that was my role in life, was to serve my husband.
Marriage rates are declining.
Feeling a bit teary after watching that.
Yeah.
Kelly and Patrick, you're the parents of 11-year-old twins. One of them, Willow, is here with us tonight. Hi, Willow. Kelly, what's the main difference between your twins?
From very early on, that it's been obvious that they're extremely different. Bonnie is a stereotypical female, always loved to dance and to do cartwheels and play with dolls and blankets and very, very much stereotypical. Willow, however, was never interested in anything that their sister was playing with and would often just play on their own or play musical instruments or want to play with their brother more. So when we'd be out in public, it was always, oh, mate, buddy, that type of reference towards Willow, where it's obvious when Bonnie and Willow would be together, that Bonnie was treated as a girl and Willow was often treated as a boy.
How did you feel when people thought Willow was a boy?
I felt like I needed to correct them. I felt protective of Willow because even though their appearance may come across that way, I had often said to Willow, if it makes you feel uncomfortable, you can say things like, my mum has short hair and she's a girl, and using terms like that to if they were uncomfortable. But it did come to a point where Willow asked me to stop correcting people.
When did Willow raise maybe being non-binary with you?
That was quite recent, within, I would say, the last 6 months. I think that what we actually have noticed is there's more representation in the media. For example, on Netflix, we've been watching a show called, is it A Day at a Time?
It's One Day at
Sorry.
A Time.
Sorry, One Day at a Time.
Mums always get it wrong.
Always. And within that show, there is a girl who is 15 and had come out to her parents as being gay. And this girl was in a relationship with another girl, but then we later found out that they were, in fact, identifying as non-binary.
Mm. No, you found out later.
Okay, I didn't know. Sorry. Always get it wrong.
Yeah.
So that sort of alerted me to maybe that is something that we might visit. Mm-hmm. I didn't speak about it straight away, but Willow really loved that show and watched it through quite a few times.
Mm.
So it was, yeah.
With those pronouns, was there a point through watching that show where Willow sort of said to you, I might change my pronouns?
I think I actually brought it up.
Mm.
We were having a conversation one day. Do you remember how it went, Willow? Mm. Can you tell me?
So, well, first, my friend told me all about what non-binary was. And then one night my mum started talking to me about, like, me considering being non-binary, and I just sort of went along with it because it felt right.
Did you understand what non-binary meant?
I did. I did understand it because I had actually researched it myself, because I was trying to find ways to make Willow more comfortable, knowing that Willow was not feeling comfortable with being referred to as either a boy or a girl. Being a parent, I needed to try and understand that. So I started taking notice of things in the media, and that, you know, people like G Flip, for example, had come out as non-binary, and it just made me wonder. So as I looked further in and learnt more, I recognised it and wanted Willow to be able to have the language again, like I said earlier. You know, I'm just trying to help guide them through a way to be comfortable within their own skin.
Given Willow had often been seen as a tomboy, did this sort of surprise you at all?
Not at all. Mm. It did, because when I grew up, there was no such thing as non-binary, or, you know, there was no representation of it. There were always people who you weren't quite sure, or there was always people who were either tomboys or boys that were feminine. And I guess as with modern times, there is that mindset of, is it a phase, or is this just a trendy thing that kids are going through these days? But I do think it's important to be able to have that label and for somebody to be able to understand themselves. So that's why I felt it was important to find that for Willow. And I don't think that I suggested to Willow, maybe you should try being non-binary. It was more, do you think that that's how you might feel?
Mm.
I think that that's how I, do you think? Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Patrick, you're Willow's dad. How did you respond when Kelly told you that Willow felt comfortable with that non-binary term?
When Kel instantly brought that up, I'm like, okay, I wasn't quite sure about it. I'd say I was unsure because I didn't know.
Right.
I've never really encountered or associated or been around or involved anyone who does identify as non-binary. I never had any friends, family members, anything like that. I was unsure because I didn't know.
Kim, at some point down the line, if Morgan questioned her gender identity, how would you respond to that?
I think I always would like to see myself as a type of parent that would, and like any parent out there in the world, is to listen, be present, and to use love to guide and see where Morgan wants to go.
You found it challenging to go off your hormone therapy when you carried Morgan. Morgan is now 4.5 months now. Are you planning to go back on that therapy?
Absolutely. But we're also thinking about having a second baby. So lots of things in consideration.
Mm.
So I would like to see us try for a second baby first.
Pharrell, you lived as a female early on, and you now live as a male. Do you still lean into masculinity as much as you did when you first transitioned to living as a male?
You know what? No, not anymore. I wanted to be the manliest man I could be. But no, I don't, because I always say that I look back as myself as a young female, and I always envision myself as today going back to that little girl and giving her a hug and smiling, because the man that I so much wanted to be, this masculine, dominant man, which got me nowhere, but now that I can look back to my future self as I am today, I've become the man that little girl wanted to be. I am all the man I can be today, and I will be more of that and all of that tomorrow. And so, no, I'm not as masculine as maybe I was yesterday, but I think I'm a gentleman, and I think that's all that matters to me.
Matt, you're still searching for your gender identity. How will you feel if you can't put a label on it?
Personally, I'm okay with that. It may be one of those things that I never find, and I feel like I'm at peace with that.
Sal, why do you think people struggle with there being so many labels around gender?
Because there are so many. So the sheer number of them makes it confusing, and you're sort of then living in fear that if you get something wrong, you're going to be given a really scary, harmful, horrible label that you have no control over and no say in.
Christian, do you think the reactions to the dress you wore at the Logies will cause as much controversy in, say, 5 or 10 years' time?
Oh, I hope not. I really do. I mean, look at Julia Morris. She came out there and she began the whole ceremony and she was wearing a tuxedo and no one batted an eye. But you go back 60, 70 years and, you know, that thought is insane. I hope that we view men in dresses in the same regard.
Grace, is your gender as non-binary set in stone?
I'm not sure. In terms of labels, I respect them for other people, but I don't really care too much with me. Honestly, I'd be happy if people called me non-binary, a man, whatever. The thing that I don't like is when people just tell me, no, you have to be a girl.
Thank you. Thank you to you all for being here tonight and for having such a respectful conversation about such a difficult topic. Thank you too for tuning in. Stay tuned for Dateline coming up next.